Welcome to Intangibles, a podcast about traits, behaviors, and qualities that entrepreneurs can cultivate to help them be successful. I'm your host, Steve Berg. I'm a partner at a New York City-based venture capital fund called Lytical Ventures. Season 4 is brought to you by Denton's Venture Technology Group at dentonsventurebeyond.com. Operating as a boutique within the world's largest law firm, the Venture Technology Group runs with hard-charging tech entrepreneurs to drive growth through strategic business, finance, and legal advice from Silicon Valley and New York to London, Berlin, Hong Kong, and beyond. Learn more at dentonsventurebeyond.com. Also, please find Intangibles on the web at www.intangiblespodcast.com. Perpetual optimism is a force multiplier. Colin Powell said that, and I don't know how it can be any clearer or more succinct. Being an optimist isn't always easy. Life isn't always easy. In the face of long odds or disappointment, it takes determination. But really, what do you have to lose? Certainly, it's better than walking around discouraged and negative. Has negativism accomplished even a fraction of what positivity has? The answer is certainly no. My guest today is the world-famous poker player, Phil Hellmuth, and he's going to set us straight on positivity. When he has his game face on, there are few that would label Phil as an outwardly positive guy. But away from the game, he is a longtime optimist, and I dare say, a positivity enthusiast. Recently, he's written a book entitled Hashtag Positivity, You Are Always in the Right Place and the Right Time. And I would like to extend a special congratulations to Phil on his 15th World Series of Poker bracelet, which he won only a couple weeks ago. Phil, very nice to meet you. Welcome to Intangibles.
Thank you for that intro. 15 world championships. I like hearing that.
Yes.
Last month.
Yes. Congratulations on that. That was only a couple of weeks ago. Quite an accomplishment. Does that count as the power of positivity, I assume?
I mean, I did keep my head up all summer, you know, which I think, you know, it's challenging to do when I wasn't having a great summer, but I had some great stuff happen financially, some life-changing money. And so I kind of told myself, don't whine too much because you're running great in business, you know, and keep your head up every day. And don't you complain too much because you've had this huge hit and, you know, try to keep going forward and smiling. And it seemed like I only had two kind of card rushes and like 30 days. I mean, only twice where I really caught some big cards. And I was just like, man, you know, but I was trying to keep my head up and understand the big picture, you know? And so I kind of hung in there right till the end and picked up a bracelet in July, which was great. Nothing great in May or June, but played every day in June basically. But there it was.
Genius. All right. Look, before we start, I had Zach Elwood, who's a former tour pro, on, and I was like, hey, tell me a crazy poker store. And I'm assuming that like all poker players have these like colorful stories of, you know, wild hands, bad beats, colorful, the whole thing, right? And he's the most kind of like low-key, polite, deferential guy. And he told me this really tame story. So I'm hoping that you've got a good yarn or a legend or something to kick us off with.
Well, I mean, you know, I think I'm the poker brat. So, you know, my autobiography, Poker Brat, has been out a year. And you know, and now my book, Hashtag Positivity, is starting to crush it. That came out in February. So, of course, I have, you know, stories dating back to 1987 about poker hands.
Yeah.
I do have one where I was playing backgammon once. We're going way back to 1986. I'm playing backgammon and I have a piece of my friend, and we're in Madison, Wisconsin. We're playing against a super rich Korean guy. And then one of those hands, we just had to double, double, double. One of those games where he had to double us, we had to take, you know, and backgammon gets like that. And then somehow we won we needed to have a really good roll on the last roll, and we hit it for, I believe, $3,200. We're talking about 1985. $3,200 was a lot of money. And our Korean opponent said, you know, whatever, he handled himself well. You could tell he was just completely bummed out. And he's like, just leave the backgammon board so I can practice. And my friend, we just won like 3,201 game. We were up like almost $5,000. My friend is just not very, was very thick. And so he's like, no. And I'm like, dude, you have 10 backgammon boards. Leave the backgammon board. And he's like, no. And then this guy grabs a kitchen knife. And my friend is holding the board. Imagine he has two arms across the board and he's holding it near his stomach. You got the vision there? The picture?
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
And this guy takes the butcher knife and just slashes between his hands.
Whoa.
You know, I mean, his hands were pretty well spread apart, slashes downward. And I'm like, I started to move towards the door and I said, I'm not going to defend you. I will call the police later, but you're an idiot. Give him the board. And so finally my friend set the board down and we left. It's just like, what were you doing?
So
that's probably the most violent, you know, story I have.
That's a
goes way back.
So I think you've now acquitted the poker playing ilk more properly, ironically, of course, with a backgammon story. Okay. Look, I'm going to give you a little warning here. I'm going to lay out a couple of situations and just let you riff off them. But some of the questions are a little bit long, so bear with me. All right. First one. So the philosopher Seneca, he says that if one does not know which port one is sailing to, no wind is favorable. I think that that is actually the point of the first chapter of your book, which is to accomplish anything you need to proceed with a purpose. And you can't do that unless you first establish a purpose. So why don't you tell the Michigan bar story and the epiphany that you had that helped you define your purpose?
Well, that's a Wisconsin bar story. So I'm living in Madison,
Wisconsin
at the time.
Sorry.
And I go to, you know, I had $20,000 in the bank. I'm 22, 23 years old, I think, you know, and I'd paid off my student loans. And, you know, we're talking about, you know, 1986, 20K seemed like a lot of money to me, you know? And I mean, heck, if you had a job, if you got a decent job, it paid $30,000 a year back then. And I had 20 in the bank already. And so it's just one of these miserable days in the Midwest, you know? And there's no sun. It's just like, there's snow on the ground and I'm just incredibly restless. And so I go to play this $2, $4 game where the most I could win is maybe $300, $400. And I'm just like, what am I doing? You know, I mean, what am I doing at this game? I convince two of my friends to leave with me. We drive a half a mile to a bar. I mean, you talk about the definition of a hole in the wall. You know, we go in there, we smoke some pot. I was never a big pot guy, but I did this on this occasion. We had a drink. I'm on my first drink. And we're playing pool, $10, $20 a game. And it just suddenly hits me. It's like that song from the Talking Heads, many days go by, water flowing underground. Same as ever was. And it's just like the passage of time, you know, and where are you in life? And I'm like, this is what's happened in my life. I'm in a bar. It's 1 in the afternoon. I'm drinking. I never drink in the day. And I've smoked pot. And so I'm just like, I got to get out of here. This just vision comes up. Get out of here as fast as you can. And I go to the side door and I open it and boom, you know, it'd been a miserable day. And the sun just hits me full force, but it's also bouncing off snow. You look forward, you know, 20 feet and there's a street and there's melted piles of snow, you know, on the curb. You know, if you live in the Midwest, you know that they kind of, the street cleaners put it on the, you know, the street sweepers kind of put it on the, and so you, there's just ice and snow melting everywhere. And I'm hit by this blinding blast of light. And I'm like, this is it. There's something going on. And I get out of there as soon as I can. I hopped in a taxi and went back to my house. And I said, all right, if you want to be a professional poker player, then you're going to become the best in the world. I didn't even shoot for best in the world. I just said, great. If you want to be a professional poker player, you're going to become great. And I write that in there. I thought, all right, I just started writing down my life goals. Okay. Then I started writing down what I call Phil's winning pyramid, you know, where, all right, let's take a look at 10 blocks in a pyramid. The bottom row is kind of weaknesses. Okay. All right, let's make sure we don't drink a lot and do drugs. That was kind of easy for me. Let's make sure that we don't gamble. Let's make sure that we're starting to eat healthier food and we're working out. And so there's kind of these blocks in there. And so, you know, how do I get to these life goals? Well, you know, let's take a look at our strengths and weaknesses, finish the pyramid. And I just felt like this was the biggest kind of day of my life. And, you know, the chapter in my autobiography where I talk about this day, I think I call it The Light Shined On or something like that. And, you know, I can see the light. That's the name of it. And so for the first time ever, I said, all right, you're going to take a good mathematical look at poker. You're going to treat this as a business, you know, and you're going to shoot for greatness. And then my life goals was pretty amazing. I wrote them all down, call it, you know, 1987, late 87, early 1988. Now, at that point, I didn't have a girlfriend. In 89, I won the main event, and then I met a girl. And then by December, we decided to get married. And she found this goal sheet in 1990. And she said, oh my God, you've achieved all of your lifetime goals, except one New York Times bestseller. And then in 2004, Play Poker Like the Pros hit the New York Times bestseller list. So I was walking around high for a couple of weeks, all lifetime goals achieved, but then you add new lifetime goals as you go. And so in 93, when I won three bracelets, so I said, all right, I want to become the greatest poker player of all time. And the only way we can measure that is by bracelets won, because cash games, you know, some people start with money. Some people are just good at getting in good games. There's too many variables.
Yeah.
You know, some people are better at borrowing money than others. So, you know, we do know some of who the great cash game players are, but it's harder to get there, you know. And so, you know, and so that was kind of an amazing day for me that kind of set my future, like you said. And all right, now all of a sudden, all oars are rowing in the right direction,
right,
towards poker greatness.
Right.
I'm not just floating around aimlessly. There are those people today in today's world that say floating around aimlessly with your sails up and following the wind wherever it goes is a good strategy. And maybe it is for some people. But my book, hashtag positivity, you know, I mean, that's the first chapter, writing your life goals. The second chapter is one of my favorites. You write down your yearly goals and tape them to your bathroom mirror.
Yep. I was going to ask about that. This you've even started to talk about this, how you align your big goals with your small goals, right?
Absolutely. They have to align. So once you write down, all right, this is what I can do this year to get towards my lifetime goals. They have to align. And then, you know, and then the other thing I do, another chapter three, is I write down my blessings and tape them on my bathroom mirror. So that way in the morning, okay, I have a direction. I can see, all right, these are my yearly goals and these are all the blessings. So I kind of leave the house in a good mood. And, you know, whether or not, you know, once you have your goals up there for a couple months, you don't consciously see them anymore. You know, but unconsciously, subconsciously, you know, it's there. You see it every day. And, you know, and I think it helps people's moods to have the you know, the blessings taped to their mirror, and it helps their direction.
So so your bathroom mirror has played a big role in your life. Your mother did something with regard to the bathroom mirror as well. Do you want to relate that?
Huge, 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 huge in my life. My mom had the saying on our bathroom mirror. Now imagine, I'm going to paint a picture for you. There's seven of us. We all live on one floor of a house. I had my own bedroom. My brother has his own bedroom, and my three little sisters shared a bedroom, and my parents had their own bedroom. So seven of us, there was one shower in the house. So you went into this bathroom. There were seven people a day taking showers, brushing their teeth, you know, doing all the stuff that, you know, girls and women need to do. And then, you know, and so that sign, you are what you think.
That's the sign. That's what she did, right? Yes.
What you think becomes reality. I'll repeat it again. You are what you think. You become what you think. What you think becomes reality. That sign would get dingy and yellow after a year, and then boom, there'd be a new one up saying the exact same thing for the third time. You are what you think. You become what you think. What you think becomes reality. And so right away, we were taught when we were young that that our minds could influence exactly our reality. And my brother has a law firm with 60 attorneys working for him, Helmuth & Johnson. Mm-hmm. And my sister Carrie just got her PhD, and she also has a law degree. And my sister Molly's one of the leading water engineers in the world. And my other sister Anne is in Special Olympics, winning gold medals, and somehow as a Special Olympian got straight A's in college. And so that goal, we all thought, you know, you are what you think. You become what you think. What you think becomes reality. Therefore, what I think becomes reality, I can kind of choose my path in life. And so I feel like we've all been super successful. We were all exposed to the power of thoughts at a young age. Yep. And so, yeah, there was that growing up. And then, as my wife will tell you, you know, there's my yearly goals on the bathroom mirror, and there's my blessings on the bathroom mirror.
Thanks, Mom. Okay, so the blessings. Let's talk about, so research suggests that gratitude positively affects health, mental well-being, demeanor. Why don't you talk a little bit about how you decided to start a gratitude practice and how that's affected you?
Well, it's great because people lose touch, right? I mean, some of the richest, most successful people in the world aren't nearly as thankful as they should be. And so somebody who's looking in from the outside will say, oh my God, if I had all that, I'd be happy. Not really. Not really. If you had all that, you might be too focused on the journey, maybe too focused on the stuff you don't have. You might be looking at the billionaire next door and saying, well, I need this and this and this. So for me, as a reality check, you know, I can tell you right now, and I talk about this in Positivity, again, Positivity only on Amazon, hashtag Positivity, takes 70 minutes to read. But I can tell you this, everybody who does this, who writes down their blessings and tapes on their bathroom mirror, is going to have health at the top of their list. It's always about health. That's what it comes down to. So your health is going to be at the top of the list, good health or great health. You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
And so that's something that's good to see every day. Wow, I have good health. I have great health. I have perfect health. You know, that's really important to look at. And then, you know, family is always number two. And just, you can just save time and write that down. And yeah, I have 15 world championships. That's number three on my list.
Right.
The money I have, number four or five on the list. Mm. The house that I'm living in, that I'm talking in right now, is on the list. But you know, you have to, so writing down your blessings is super important.
Yeah.
And if I don't see that, I play in a regular poker game where I'm the poorest guy by far.
Mm-hmm.
You know, the minimum of that game is a guy worth $100 million. All right. He's the poor guy. And then there's me. So I could be focused on what I don't have because all my friends have that as far as money goes, or I can be focused on what I do have.
Yeah.
You know, a New York Times bestselling book, you know, all of this stuff is on my list. And that's always going to charge me up. There's gratitude for that every day. And whether I see it or not, I kind of realize I'm blessed. And, you know, and then I leave the house.
It's good.
So, I'm sure that gratitude helps. And when I get stuck sometimes, when I'm a little depressed or down or whatever, or too egotistical, then I think it really helps to take a look at that list.
It's good for perspective. Okay, here's scenario number two. And I know you have an affinity for Michael Jordan. And so there's this great Michael Jordan quote in which he says, I've missed more than 9,000 shots in my career. I've lost almost 300 games. 26 times I've been trusted to take the game-winning shot and missed. In my mind, this is actually a quote about positivity because it shows what Michael Jordan had to fight through in order to achieve so much success. What do you think?
Yeah, I mean, those are good points, you know, and I look at all the poker tournaments that I didn't win, and I think I have 10 seconds at the World Series of Poker with my 15 first. And so some people are, that's impressive, but it's easy to look back and say, oh my God, that's 10 times I didn't get the job done, you know.
Mm-hmm.
Same thing in baseball, you know, where, but the point is to put yourself in position to do some great things.
Right.
And God knows Michael Jordan hit enough game winners, and God knows he won enough championships.
That's right.
You know, and so, you know, I also think with MJ, he had a chip on his shoulder all the way through at 50 years old. So when he gave his Hall of Fame induction speech.
Yes.
And, you know, so some people are like, well, that's a little bit harsh. You're still talking about, your high school basketball coach and how he didn't put you on the varsity when you were a sophomore. You know what I mean? But you have to have perspective and understand that what drove MJ, part of what drove him, was all the slights.
Yeah.
And, you know, and that's Daniel Negreanu has continuously attacked the way I play poker.
Yep.
And, you know, that has been, that's been good for me. And Daniel and I joke about it on the phone. You know, I've said, hey, you're good for me. And now he starts off conversation sometimes like, I'm good for you, aren't I? And I'm like, you are, because you won't give me any credit.
Right.
You know?
Yeah.
I mean, most people that have 15, I mean, when you, yeah, I have 15 world championships, the next guys have 10.
Yeah.
So I've kind of set myself apart a little bit.
Totally.
But Negreanu won't give me any credit. And so, you know, he came out and went public in October. I baited him a little bit. When he and I battle on social media, I type quickly and I already know what I'm going to say 10 steps in advance. So I baited him into posting a list of 40 people that he said are better than me at No Limit Hold'em tournaments. And I said, well, we'll see. I said, here's what I'll do. I'll bet you $20,000 per player we can bet on who wins the bracelet next.
Oh.
You know, but I get laid for, but I get 800,000 when I win. And every time they win, I'll throw you 20,000. He passed on that smartly. But I mean, you know, but Negreanu can be a bit delusional. And, you know, he'll accuse me of being delusional. So we're being fair in this discussion. You know, he thinks I'm delusional because I think I'm great at poker. And, you know, I think he's delusional because he doesn't recognize how great I am at poker. But it makes for kind of a fun friendship.
Yeah.
And we get along really well. And certainly when we do the ESPN coverage together, a lot of people, I mean, will love to see that, where he kind of makes fun of me and beats me up a little bit. And
yeah.
I throw a few punches back, and it's good television and it's fun.
So, I mean, there's a couple things that I would say about that. I mean, the corollary in poker, there's about 200,000 players in the U.S. poker base, but only 15 to 20,000 of those players are net winners in any given year. So that means there's about only 7.5 to 10% of the folks that are winning. And that's not all that high, right? So you're talking about this delusion. There's a behavioral psychologist, his name is Daniel Kahneman, and he talks about this thing called delusional optimism, right? And basically that is that, you know, you have to have almost a delusion to believe that you can do something that is so statistically difficult to do it, right? Otherwise, where are you, right? And I think that's why positivity is such an interesting propulsive force.
Yeah, and you know, I mean, to cut to positivity for a second, you know, I think for me, so the delusional optimism, I don't think I'm delusional, but certainly could be argued, you know, if someone thinks they can win 15 bracelets, they're delusional. I've done it though. But I think when I cut to positivity, you know, that the subtitle for that, we're always in the right place
at the right time
every day. And so it's been so much fun for me to show the world that, you know, on Tim Ferriss show and all these shows I've been doing,
yeah,
to show the world that.
Yeah.
And that one I love because, you know, I have the perfect example of that, and people, it opens people's eyes, and people are tweeting me, you've changed my life. They read hashtag positivity, 70 minutes, mm-hmm. 8 life tips.
Mm-hmm.
And they're tweeting me, you changed my life, Phil, you changed my life. And it's kind of nice. And I think I'm going to get that the rest of my life. And Tony Robbins is truly not making this up. He is recommending my book when he's all over the world right now.
Yeah.
He's telling people to buy my book. So not only is he on the back, and Sheryl Sandberg gave me the most impressive quote of all, but he's recommending that people buy this book, hashtag positivity, at his seminars. And so it's just amazing to me. And it's been.
All right. Well, why don't you talk us through the 8 tips, the checklist?
Well, I don't want to give away all 8, but I will say that the always in the right place at the right time is more simple than people think. And how did I arrive at that conclusion? I live in the Bay Area.
Yeah.
And so we were fortunate enough to send our kids to Bing School, and, you know, and which is the number one preschool in the world. And, you know, but the people that I meet along the way, super successful people, they kept saying I was in the right place at the right time. I kept hearing it so often in the 90s that I was like, what the hell is going on here? Right. You know? And so I started thinking about it because God knows I have a lot of time on my hands, especially in the 90s, you know, and I kept thinking, you know, we're always in the right place at the right time. And so I like to tell this story both in the book and sometimes in interviews. And that's simply this. You have a guy who, two guys, one guy lays out in front of his wife and two kids, the perfect sports bar. This is my dream. Then he says, Martha, please pass the peas. I got that line from Carl Westcott. So I was piecing this stuff together. And he's like, that's right. People do have amazing ideas. They don't follow through.
Right.
Second person, wife, two kids, lays out the idea for the perfect sports bar, but he makes a mental note. Tomorrow, I'm going to go by my favorite sports bar and talk to the owner. So what is he doing? He's opened a door. That's it. He's opened a door. He's gone into, figuratively and literally, when he walked into his favorite sports bar, and he wants to meet the owner of that sports bar. Okay. And so maybe he doesn't meet him that day, but maybe another day. He's walked through this door. Maybe the owner of the sports bar says, all right, you know, I'm ready to sell. I like your style. I like your dream. I like your vision. I'm going to keep 30% of the bar. I'm going to sell 70% to you. The point is, he opened a door.
Yep.
Maybe this, and there's six other doors behind it. So the one guy, Martha, please pass the peas, he never saw the obvious door in front of him. The other guy saw that door, opened it. Door A could be behind that door. Door A could be, I'll help you with the financing. Door B could, I'll introduce you to the right people. Door C, there's all these doors. Even on the far left, call it door Z, could be the door where the guy says, man, you know, if you do this, you're going to have to work 60, 70 hours a week. You have to be able to open and close the bar, and maybe the guy gives up on the dream.
But at least he opened the door, right?
The point is, he opened the door and saw the next six doors, and then he went through the next door too. So that guy, so we're always in the right place at the right time. Okay. But most people don't recognize it. So in positivity, I talk to people about, all right, let's recognize your dream. There's a chapter on, and then, you know, and is there a way that you could open a door and move towards that dream?
Right.
And for most people, yes, there is a door. It's a pretty easy and simple door.
Excellent. I'm going to change topics for a second here, and I want to talk a little bit about self-talk. I've seen times where you start talking to yourself, both negatively and positively. I know there's that one really widely seen clip of you saying, I can dodge bullets, baby. yeah. how does your self-talk impact your ability to stay positive and ultimately impact your success?
As positive as I am, sometimes I'm on the golf course in a match and I start whining a little bit and my partner's like, whoa, where are you going negative? I'm like, I'm not really going negative. I'm just kind of calling myself out to refocus. And so, you know, you think about, you know, when I won Brace at 15, I made a bad call when I was heads up, lost way too many chips with second pair. And I was like, Phil, that was a horrible call. What were you thinking? You know, now everybody watching knows it was a horrible call. I know it was a horrible call, but by taking myself to task a little bit, and what would seem like negative self-talk, I'm actually trying to get myself to refocus and pay attention and play great. And so sometimes I can use, you know, and anybody who wonders about the authenticity of me telling other people they play badly, I mean, I certainly talk about myself playing badly some too. So, you know.
Yeah. So, I mean, in a way, I think what you're saying is that if you have credible and authentic self-talk, both positive and sometimes even negative, that can kind of stop you or wean you off of going on tilt. Is that right?
I think so. You know, I think so. I mean, when I made that bad call and I was lecturing myself on the bad call, what it did was, you know, kind of refocus me. All right. Rather than keep it on the inside and say, God, I blew it there. And looking back on it and say, oh my God, if I would only wouldn't have called there, then maybe I would win this tournament and let the tournament slip through my fingers through looking back at something negative. I just blasted it out there to the world. What a bad call that was, blah, 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 blah. And just kind of like, all right, that's fine. You made a bad call. Let's move on.
Got it out.
So
move
I addressed
on.
It, got it out, moved on, refocused. And half an hour later, I had the bracelet in my hand.
Beautiful. Moving to my next scenario. So about a century ago, Louis Pasteur, the guy who invented pasteurized milk, said, chance favors only the prepared mind. So what I want to talk about is practice. How much do you practice?
So my biggest mistake from about 2004 to 2011, call it 10. My biggest mistake was not enough practice. So I look back, because I wrote the autobiography, I had to look back at my schedule. And I was working like 350 days out of the year. Even my days off, I'd write a blog. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And I was getting paid a lot of money to represent some companies. And, you know, and I was crushing it for them. But a lot of travel, a lot of commercials, it's just too much work probably. And so I just wasn't getting the reps in playing poker. Mm-hmm. And then, you know, in 2007, when poker became harder to play online, there wasn't really that many places I could even practice. So my mistake was I would play 7-card stud 8 or better once a year at the World Series of Poker, or maybe twice a year. So I just come in rusty. And then those years where I was just seeing everything and hitting the ball out of the park, I would win at everything anyway. But those years where I wasn't as practiced, I mean, those years where I wasn't at my peak, I wouldn't play the games as well.
Yep.
And so 2010, I realized, what the hell are you doing? And so 2010, I started playing at a website, $1, $2, $5 buy-in tournaments. You know, I started playing literally 10 hours a day, all the games for about just a week straight. That's it. And everything became sharp. And then, you know, I had a really good series in 2010. Actually, in 10, I didn't have a great series, but I knew I was playing well.
Yeah.
But, you know, that's just the way it goes. But then to have the 11 and 12 that I had, 11, I put in the effort, 12, I put in the effort. You know, I mean, it's amazing how when one game is under the spotlight, I started focusing more on Omaha 8 or better. And I didn't do anything in the Omaha 8 or better this year, but I had some deep, deep runs and I learned a ton. And I feel like if I can just win 3 Omaha 8 or better bracelets, I'll be can be considered the best Omaha 8 or better tournament player in the world. So you need to practice. And, you know, practice is super important. And so I don't make that mistake anymore. I always come into the series ready to play now.
Yeah. So, I mean, the way I'm interpreting that answer is that the more practiced you are, the sharper you are, and the more you come in essentially with a positive mindset, right? You know you're ready to go. You know that whatever comes in front of you, you're going to be at your best.
You know, you look at Omaha 8 or better, for example. That's exactly right. That's exactly right. Well, Omaha 8 or better, so studying with Mike the Mouth Mattis, who is one of the best in the world in tournaments. I think 3 years in a row, he made the top 10 of the Omaha 8 or better 10K, the last 3 years in a row. But talking to him about hands, I know what I need to fold, what I don't need to fold. And it just gives me tremendous confidence. And, you know, you look back last year, Mike and I got heads up in a half stud 8 or better, half Omaha 8 or better tournament at the Commerce Casino. You know, I won it. And Mike finished second. But we were the two best players in the field. Well, Benny Glazer was there. He's obviously terrific at Omaha 8 or better. But it came down to Mike and I heads up. And that was no random occurrence. That's Mike and I studying, and getting great results. And so, you know, you do have to work at games. And you do have to keep improving and learning. And when you have access to the best in the world at a game, it makes a big difference.
Yeah.
And so having access to Mike Mattisoff for a couple of those games helps me a tremendous amount. Now, the rest of the poker world's like, oh, you study with Cantu and Mattisoff. What do they know? Well, I mean, the question they should be asking is, how do you keep getting deep, Phil? These guys are obviously pretty smart, but everybody's a critic.
Right. Yeah. Yeah.
And that's okay.
Yeah. Well,
I don't mind.
Yeah. You can have them
criticize. What people should be asking, they should be saying when they see me play a No Limit Hold'em final table, and they say me do weird things that makes no sense to them, they should be asking, why is Phil doing that? How can I do that to improve my game? But instead, they're so committed to, oh, whatever the latest math and science says is the right way to play. And it's funny to me, because what I wanted to learn is I studied GTO for about a day. That's it. And I studied it in order to combat it. And the very first tournament out of the box was my 15th bracelet, because I had to understand what they were doing. I knew that weird stuff was happening in No Limit Hold'em, stuff that made no sense to me. Small ball no longer existed.
Yeah.
But I didn't understand why. So literally spent 3 or 4 or 5 hours talking about GTO, and then I understood what they were thinking and what they were doing. And once I saw that, then I was like, okay, if they're going to do this, I'm going to do that. And I was kind of mad at myself for not studying it earlier.
Yeah. Well, let me go away from that. Let me go away from math then and science. In the psychology community, creative visualization refers to the practice of seeking to affect our outer world by changing our thoughts and expectations. So basically, our minds have an enormous capacity to connect invisible dots to guide us to strive for the impossible. I maybe the answer I already know just based on that. Do you ever practice visualization? Do you see yourself winning tournaments before it happens?
I used to use a lot of visualization in the 80s and 90s.
Yeah.
All the time.
Yeah.
I was meditating a lot more back then. I haven't done a great job of keeping my meditation practice up. I probably haven't meditated enough in the last 7-8 years. You know, part of the shortcut to visualization for me is just having, you know, my yearly goals on my mirror.
Right.
So when I see that, it starts my mind along a path similar to visualization anyway.
Yeah. Yeah.
So, okay. You know.
Okay,
but
cool.
Yeah, I think visualization is absolutely a good thing. It can never be bad.
Right.
There's just nothing, you know. And what's the worst that can happen? You visualize a goal, you go after it, and you fall short.
Right.
But because you visualized it, your mind, which works on several different levels that we don't even understand, and some levels that we do understand,
right,
from subconscious to unconscious, when you're telling it, this is where I want to go, it may steer you when you're not paying it. In fact, it does steer you when you're not even paying attention.
Right. So, yeah. Okay. And so I'm on your wavelength with regard to that. I do believe in visualization. I've started to actually do more mindfulness. You're right. It's work. Just like practice is work. It's work. You've got to commit to it. How important is self-awareness to you, knowing your own strengths and weaknesses?
It's everything as a professional poker player.
It's everything.
If you don't understand your own strengths and weaknesses, then how are you going to be able to subvert them in the case of weaknesses, and how are you going to be able to extend them and do them better in the case of strengths? So, I mean, the one thing about being a professional poker player, okay, you know, the reason why a lot of the top professional poker players, a lot of professional poker players, the reason why they're so smart and so successful is because on any given day, we could lose all of our money.
Yeah.
That's a tremendous amount of pressure.
Yeah.
And so then what do? You look on the inside and you say, why did I do that? What am I capable of doing? Why would I think this way? Did I risk too much money here? It's always looking inside, looking inside, looking inside. And so then your awareness can't help but be increased, you know, exponentially as you figure stuff out. You know, they used to make fun of my money management. Why is Phil playing, you know, why in 2003, when I walk into a room or 2004, 2005, when I walk into the Commerce Casino, when there's 2 8- and 1600 games going, a 6 and 12, a 4 and 8, and a 2 and 4, why am I sitting down in the 100-200 game,
mm-hmm,
and swallowing all that ego as everybody watches me walk in the room,
mm-hmm,
and sit down at the 100-200 game? Why? Because it's the right move financially, right?
Yeah.
Oh, sure.
Big.
Maybe I'm worth a million or two on paper, but how much cash did I have then?
Right.
You know, who am I doing it for? Who am I swallowing my pride for to sit down in the 100-200 game?
Right.
For my wife and kids. It's about doing the right thing.
Yeah.
You know?
That's back to your planning, right? That's back to the planning that you talked about at the very beginning.
Now I can sit down and play a 1,000-2,000 game or 2,000-4,000 game if I choose. I can sit down and risk $100,000 a day because now I can afford to do that.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean?
Sure.
And I've been winning so much for so long, you know, I still don't do that very often. You know, why? I don't know. Why should I lose? Why should I, you know, I haven't lost. People won't even believe the stat. I haven't even lost 3 times in a row since 2015. No one even believes that, but it's pretty ballsy thing to even say, much less do. And it's after the first loss, I'm pretty mad. After the second loss, I'm like tearing things apart. And, you know, and the rare occasion where I lost the third time, I'm just like, all right, there's something wrong with the world. You know?
Well, you go back.
The point is, you
go back and calm yourself down and analyze and start to play the right way.
You go back to basics quickly because I hate losing so much. And so that's the plus side of hating losing so much.
Yeah.
Is that, you know, you're willing to make adjustments to make sure you don't lose.
Yep, for sure. Okay, we're down to the final three questions. And they're simple questions. First, is there anything about positivity that I didn't bring into the conversation that you think is really important that we should talk about?
No, I think it was good. I think it was good to talk about. I think it was important to talk about kind of the concepts we talked about. So that's good. I mean, I think it helps, you know, I think it helps me to talk about, you know, I mean, the fact is you can only buy the book at Amazon. Mm-hmm. And it's also, I'm pretty proud of that book. I mean, I think that's hopefully a big part of my legacy is to influence millions of people in a positive way. So,
yeah.
All right, go ahead.
Question number two, besides the book on the topic, when you were doing research or things that you were paying attention to, are there any materials or resources that you think are important for people to check out?
Well, I think that, you know, I think if you're really in the kind of with, and I think a lot of people do like those, then I think you get to see more of the origins of it when you actually read Poker Brat and not hashtag positivity. Mm-hmm. So, you know, I mean, this is kind of my stuff. But I mean, you know, obviously when you talk about writing down your lifetime goals, that's not a new concept. You know, someone else came up with that concept.
Right.
So, you know, other than basically tracing what I was thinking in a little more detail through reading Poker Brat, I'd say no.
Okay. And then finally, where do you prefer to have people follow you? Mostly Twitter?
Yeah. You know, I mean, I tweet. I think yesterday was the first day that I didn't send out a tweet in a long time. Some poker players were mad because I was retweeting. You know, when I won the bracelet, people were congratulating me, and I retweeted like probably 800 retweets, and people are like, damn it, Phil, you're jamming my feed.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So I've gone a little bit the other direction lately with, you know, one or two or three tweets, not much retweeting. And yesterday, I think, was the first day I didn't tweet in a long time. I noticed it.
So so that's the place you want people to go. Why don't you give your handle?
Yeah, it's at @Phil_Hellmuth.
Okay.
They told me I could have Phil Hellmuth a couple of years ago, but I just, you know, whatever. I'm just keeping Phil, you know, _.
Yeah, don't have people have to work to follow you, right? Might as well, they know where to go. They've probably forgotten about the handle by now anyway, so it doesn't matter. Okay.
Exactly.
Phil, that's the end. I think you're a great ambassador of positivity. Thank you very much. I enjoyed this conversation greatly.
Yeah, thank you. It's I just love getting the message out there. So you had some great questions.
Thanks so much. This has been Intangibles. As always, I'd like to thank Denton's Venture Technology Group at dentonsventurebeyond.com for being the sponsor this season and a supportive partner. Operating as a boutique within the world's largest law firm, the Venture Technology Group runs with hard-charging tech entrepreneurs to drive growth through strategic business, finance, and legal advice from Silicon Valley and New York to London, Berlin, Hong Kong, and beyond. Learn more at dentonsventurebeyond.com. I'd also like to thank Ben Glowy, our sound engineer. If you would like to work with him, he can be reached via Twitter. His handle is @venture_sound. And thank you. Keep an eye out for the next episode. I'm your host, Steve Berg.